This investigation is considered one of the finest pieces of detective work in the history of law enforcement. I'm Alex Tresniowski. I'm the author of The Rope, a true story of murder, heroism, and the dawn of the NAACP.
The history Alex Tresniowski shares in The Rope begins in the Jersey Shore town of Asbury Park in 1910. Asbury Park seemed like an idyllic place until a little girl went missing.
10-year-old Marie Smith, she was a schoolgirl who left for school at 8 a.m. one morning in the winter and never made it back home. And there was a 5-day manhunt for her with no clues, no sign of her, until her body turned up in the woods, battered, abused. It was a grisly crime. And almost immediately, a black handyman in town named Tom Williams was rounded up and arrested for the crime. A white mob stormed the jail and tried to pull him out and lynch him. There was no proof, there was nothing else, there was just a suspicion that he was the murderer.
In 1910, there were more than 60 lynchings reported in the United States. So long as he was a suspect, Tom Williams' life was in danger.
The prosecutor in Asbury Park, John Applegate, was convinced that Williams was the killer. But there were a couple of town officials who weren't, so they privately and secretly hired a New York detective named Raymond Schindler to come to Asbury Park and conduct a clandestine investigation and try to find another suspect and try to get to the truth.
Schindler identified another suspect, a white man who had reportedly approached Marie Smith a few days prior to her disappearance.
He used an investigator to go undercover and rope his suspect in, befriend him, gain his trust, and it was a day-to-day process, and it took weeks and months. And I've asked law enforcement officers today if this kind of operation would ever fly. The answer is no.
Schindler had several elaborate plans to smoke out a confession.
So Ray Schindler is a fan of all of Shakespeare's works. He believes that in Shakespeare's plays, characters reveal themselves through their actions, through their thoughts, which we hear through their language. And that's what he wants to do with criminals. So he actually uses a scene from Hamlet involving a ghost to sort of scare his suspect into a confession.
That guilty creature's sitting at a play. Have, by the very cunning of the scene, been struck so to the soul that presently they have proclaimed their malefactions. For murder, though it had no tongue, will speak.
And he rents out a movie theater and he shows a particular movie that is intended to scare his suspect and haunt him and get him to confess. And he tries a lot of things like that along the way, which are very unconventional. And ultimately, he begins to wear his suspect down.
Schindler also borrowed a plan from popular detective fiction.
Later on, Raymond Schindler would be called America's Sherlock Holmes, but he was aware of a Conan Doyle story, The Hound of the Baskervilles, where townspeople were terrified of a mysterious dog.
What's that? Oh, that. Well, the people around here say it's the hound.
He tried to use that to smoke out his suspect, too. He put an officer in the bushes outside his suspect's house and told him to throw a rock at a doghouse every hour on the hour after midnight to stir the junkyard dog out of his home and bark and unnerve the suspect who lived in the house. And he did this for 7 days, and sure enough, he would see the bedroom light come on, he would see the suspect pacing.
Meanwhile, Tom Williams sat in jail at risk of being lynched.
It was the fact that if a black man committed a crime against a white woman or a white girl, they were almost automatically found guilty of the crime simply because of a prevailing view that black men could be savages and had to be controlled in order to be tolerated. And this was one of those cases where the guilt just fell on Tom Williams like a hammer before anybody investigated anything.
Fortunately for Williams, he got some help from a newly formed organization. It was called the NAACP.
The Tom Williams murder investigation ended up being only the third legal case ever handled by the NAACP. And this was an organization that had just been founded a year earlier, was in its infancy, didn't have much money, and it was one of the cases where they sort of found their footing.
Ultimately, Schindler's investigation turned up the actual predator. We'll let you read the book to find out who it was, but it wasn't Tom Williams.
The legacy of the Tom Williams case, he basically disappeared afterwards. He became a nobody again. But the case mattered because it was one less black man lynched.
Raymond Schindler would go on to become one of the most famous detectives of the 20th century.
Policing and investigating can be a means of providing a community with justice, with safety, with peace, in the way that the investigative officers react with the town. It's about getting the police force to work with the community and actually be a dispenser of justice. And that's a very modern idea that we're still grappling with 110 years later. How do we make that work in America today?
Tresniowski also wanted to honor the little girl whose death was at the center of this case.
When I finished the book, I went to the cemetery where Marie Smith is buried. It's the Holy Cross Cemetery in Flatbush, Brooklyn. And I looked for her gravesite again. And this time I left a little stone on her site. It was a little marble plaque that said Marie is the flower, which is something one of her relatives said about her at one point. And it just, it was a good feeling to sort of leave something there to mark her existence. And it's important, I think, that we look that way at history, that these are lives that were lived and mattered and have something to say to us today.
This is Inside Edition Digital.